I don't know about you, but every time I sing that song, and reminds me of the scriptures in the book of Revelation.
Holy, holy, holy.
Where there's going to be multitudes. A sea of people, the Bible says, you can't even count them. That they're going to be around the throne singing, "You are holy, holy, holy."
Holy, holy, holy.
We're going to see that. I don't know about you, but I'm planning on seeing that. Because it's promised to me. From every nation, every tongue. Every person on the face of the earth who heard the gospel and was changed by the gospel, who were born again by the gospel, is going to be there singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb of God." I'm looking forward to that. I'm looking forward to a lot. There's a lot the Bible says about after this life. There's ages to come. God has more for us to be a part of than just this life. That's why the Bible says, why you want to forfeit all that's coming for this short period of time? What does it profit a man to gain the whole world if he loses his soul? What profit? What good is it? For this short amount of time we're on earth, you're going to sacrifice eternity. It don't make sense. But thank God that we got the promise of eternity. Hallelujah. There's something we're looking forward to even beyond this life. Because this life is going to end. How many know that? It's going to end. Okay, how long you live, one day it's going to be over. Then what? I know what. I'm going to say Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Well, I want to wish every one of you a happy and blessed new year. This is our first Sunday service in this year. But I tell you, we're going to have 51 more this year. That's what we got to look forward to. 51 more times we're going to be meeting on Sunday morning. So I titled the message today, which is our first service of the new year, "Hope for 2019. So I have to ask ourselves, is there hope for us this year? I believe my toughest New Year's message was 2006, after Hurricane Katrina, when 600 people in our congregation lost everything they had, everything we had. 15 years of ministry went down the drain. There was nothing left. And I had a remnant of people that met in a borrowed church that I preached the 2006 message to on hope. It was the toughest. Because I couldn't tell them what 2006 was going to bring. I didn't even know what I was going to do. Lost my house, lost my church, lost the ministry. And we gathered probably about 70 people that I could get my hands. Our people were scattered all over the South. The whole community was destroyed, didn't know where to build, didn't know what to do, fighting the insurance company, didn't know what to do. But I can stand here now, after 13 years, and tell you we have three churches. We got three church buildings, and God is blessing us. We're doing more than I could ever dream or imagine, and what we're going to do. So I know that there's hope. There's hope for 2019. So if that's so, then what are the objects or the focus of our hope? You know, when people use the word hope in the world in casual conversation, it often has a negative, wavering, uncertainty, doubtful sound about it. Yeah, people, "Well, how are you doing?" "Well, I hope I'm going to make it." Well, what are you doing? Well, I hope everything's gonna be all right. But in the Bible, the word hope is always an expectation of something good. See, that's the hope of the Bible. You see, the Bible seldom uses the word hope in a negative, doubtful way, because the people of God, in other words, the life of a true born-again believer, has hope. Talking about hope.
Amen.
You see, our former life, before you came to Christ, as an unbeliever, not now, thank God, not now, but as a believer, we have to believe, and I tell people all the time, my future is fantastic. I don't care what this world dishes to me. I don't care what I have to face. My future is fantastic. Can you say that with me? Say, my future is fantastic. Why? Because I have hope. See, I have hope. See, I believe my future is going to be fantastic. Paul tells the Ephesian church this in Ephesians chapter 2. Verse 12, he says, remember that at that time, talking about a time before Christ, you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel, and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ Jesus, you who were once far away have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. In other words, before we came to Christ and put our faith in Jesus Christ, and God changed our life, we become born again, we were living in a world without hope and without God. You were living on, depending on luck. People used to wish you good luck. Don't wish me good luck. My life is nothing about luck. My life is nothing about winning the lottery. My life is nothing about having a good break. My life is knowing that God is going to supply everything I have need of. See, biblical hope focuses on God, not chance. Not winning the lottery, not winning on a roulette wheel, not winning at poker, not winning at anything like that. But my hope is focused on God. And when my hope focuses on God, it fills us with an eager expectation, because He can do it. He has all the means to bless my life. So my hope is in Him. So hope is really a reflection of Christian character. See, it's part of our character. As a believer, I live my life in hope. I don't live my life in doubt, in despair, and not knowing. I live every day of my life in hope because of what God has promised me. See, so remember, hope is always referring to the future. And Paul tells us that hope is not what we have now, it's what we're hoping for. See, we're looking forward to. See, we don't have it yet, but my hope is I'm going to get it. See, the book of Romans, Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verse 24, for in this hope we were saved. But hope that is seen is no hope at all.
Amen.
Who hopes for what he already has? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. So when we said we have hope, I'm hoping this year what God's going to bring to me. What God's going to give me. I don't have it yet. But I have hope that good stuff's coming. I got hope that everything I have need of, God is going to supply for me. See, there are going to be material things we're going to need, of course. We need material things. Some of us might need a house, a place to live. We might need a new car. We might need appliances. We might need a new job. We might need a raise. And the list goes on. In fact, our church, we need a church building immediately. I think it's coming. I don't know where, I don't know how. We keep looking, we keep knocking, we keep searching, but I have hope that it's going to come this year. I have hope. Why? Because God knows we need it. Okay? So, but God says he will supply all of our material needs. Paul said, my God will supply all of our needs through his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. What are you worrying about? God's going to do that. So our spiritual needs, though, are the most important thing.
Amen.
Our spiritual needs being met are more important than our material needs.
Amen.
I'm hoping for spiritual blessings this year. I'm hoping to be a better pastor. I'm hoping to be a better man of God. I'm hoping for the things that God has promised me. So when we survive this year, and we will, it's not going to be because we got more material stuff. It's going to be because we have grown spiritually, that we're becoming rich spiritually, not materially. So to survive 2019, I'm going to tell you, you're going to do it by having hope in God. That's it. You don't have hope in God, you can forget 2019. You forget it. But the Apostle Paul tells us, how do you get to that place where you can say, I have hope in God? What is it? How do we get there? Well, there's a process that the Bible talks about. Paul tells us what the process is in Romans chapter 5. He said, therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand. And we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also rejoice in our suffering, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character. And character, hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us. Paul said we have hope because God has poured out his love into our hearts by his Holy Spirit. This is where hope comes from. It's what God does for us. Is what God has done for us. He said, by faith we've been justified. I like that. You talk about hope. When you know you're right with God, when God has forgiven you of all your sins, you got a new life in God, God put his Spirit in you, then you know you're right with God, you've been justified. That'll bring peace to you. And then by faith we gain access into his grace, his favor. His grace, his favor. His grace is stuff we don't deserve, but God's going to give it to us anyway. God will pour out his blessing to make you fall on your knees and say, I really don't deserve all of
it.
I don't deserve it. But yet, God gives it to us. Then he says, we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. But here's the process. Here's the process for hope. Paul says, we also rejoice in our suffering. And what? We're going to rejoice in our suffering? Come on. No, this is what Paul said. You need to rejoice in the suffering. If you're going through suffering right now, you need to rejoice in it. Why? Because Paul says we know that suffering produces perseverance. Persevering. We might have to persevere here. In this year, 2019. You don't know what we have to. We don't know what's coming. That's why we need hope. We don't know what's coming. You watch the news, you know that you don't know what in the world's going to happen day to day. But by suffering produces perseverance, but then when we persevere, it produces character. See, there's a process going on here. Character, and then once we have character, I got hope. So here's the process. Suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character. Character produces hope. Now there's a lot of professing Christians that lack hope. They don't have hope. You talk to them. You know what's coming out of their mouth. They don't have hope. And why they don't have hope? Simply because they don't have any character. It's because in suffering, they didn't persevere. They didn't learn anything. They didn't let God do something for them. Let me tell you something. Everything, every trial you face. Listen, people look at me and Sister Dawn say, man, I wish we could be like you. I remember Pastor Joseph when we first started the church. He said, I just want to be like you. I said, brother, this is going to take you. It's going to take you 46 years to be like me. See, you don't know what I've been through. You don't know the problems and the trials I had to face as a believer. Just because you're a believer don't mean everything's going to go right for you. God will use those things. Paul said, for all things, in all things, in all things God is working for the good of them that love God and called according to his purpose. God's going to use everything in your life to form you, to give you some character. So when you're suffering, it doesn't mean God's against you. God is with you. God is going to take whatever trial or tribulation you're going through, he's going to take it to change you. He's going to put some character in you. See, they got some Christians that don't have hope simply because they don't have any character, because they can't persevere in suffering. They give up. They talk the talk, but they don't walk the walk. They get discouraged at the least bit of affliction. Oh, God, this ain't working. This Christianity ain't working. Look all that I'm going through. What are you going through? That's the time when you're going through it. That's the time to cry out to God. Say, God, what are you doing to me? Listen, I've learned every trial, every tribulation, every hardship that I have to persevere through, when I come out on the other side, I'm different. That's what God wants. How are you going to change? If everything went right for you, you would never change. It's through the suffering. It's through the trials. It's going through financial hardships, physical hardship, all the family hardships, whatever it is. You persevere through that. You rejoice in your suffering. Why? Because God's going to take that suffering. And he's going to do something with it to profit me. But there's too many Christians that get discouraged at the least bit of affliction. Somebody steps on their foot in church, they're ready to leave. Somebody didn't tell them hello when they walked in, they're ready to leave. You're ready to leave with that. What you going to do when persecution comes? What are you going to do when our government says you can't be a Christian and we got to hide and go have services? What are you going to do then? When you get challenged by being put in jail for doing what we're doing now. Go to China. What we're doing right now, you will be arrested for. You think you'd come here and smile? Knowing that they can bust through that door right now, take us all to jail. What are you going to do then? I want to go to John. I want to get with those guys who are bold enough to serve the Lord Jesus Christ, even though it would cost them jail time. That's the kind of people I want to hang around with. Not them people that as soon as you say the wrong thing, yeah, oh, them people, I'm out of here. Character as a Christian develops when all hell breaks out against you and you stand your ground. When the fires are burning, the shots are fired, you're still there. Do what you got to do. My hope is in the Lord. My hope is in the Lord Jesus Christ. You see, because, see, I don't know what 2019 is going to bring to each and every one of us. I don't know what it's going to bring to you. God knows. I don't know what's coming to me. I don't know what's going to happen with me. But I do know this. Without hope, you're not going to survive. If you don't believe that whatever 2019 brings us, you're going to make it through, you're done for. You're done for. But we're going to face 2019, losing 3 years. You won't survive. But just what Paul said, hope doesn't disappoint us. You got that? Didn't he say that?
Amen.
He said that hope, once you've rejoiced in your suffering, once you've persevered, and you develop character, and you wind up with the end result of hope, Paul says hope never disappoints us. God said, if you just trust in me and hope in me, you'll never be disappointed. I'll take that. That's why, come hell or high water, I'm going to stick. I'm going to stick. You can say what you want to say. And why does hope never disappoint us? Well, because Paul says we have this hope because God poured out his love into our hearts by his Holy Spirit. So hope for 2019 is going to be contingent upon this. How much of God's love can we grasp? How much of it can we realize that God loves us? You see, this is how hope is measured. It's not about how much God gives us in the material world, but how much of God's love can I grasp? How much of it? How much can I conceive of God's love? When trials and tribulations come my way, can I still feel the love of God? Can I still know that God loves me enough to get me through it? Can I do that? See, our hope is rooted in the love of God. It's rooted there. And the Apostle Paul brings more clarity to this truth in his letter to the Ephesian church. Paul's letter to the Ephesian church, if you read the whole letter, it contains a lot of instruction, a lot of doctrine. But right in the middle of the letter, in chapter 3, right in the middle of the letter, Paul breaks out with a prayer for the church. And in that prayer, Paul reveals their greatest need. And this is what it is. In Ephesians 3:14, Paul says, "For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the saints to grasp how wide, how long, how high, and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. What a powerful prayer. What a powerful prayer. And Paul was praying right in the middle of this letter. He had to start praying for them that they would be rooted and established in God's love. You see, verse 18 says, may have power together with all the saints to grasp. See, this is what we got to grasp here in 2019. You have to grasp how wide, how long, how high, and how deep is the love of Christ. That's what we got to hold on to. Amen. That's our hope. That's our hope. See, the love of Christ is perfect. See, 1 John 4:18, John says, there is no fear in love. But perfect love drives out fear. Because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. Perfect love drives out fear. So if you have any fear about 2019, guess who's going to drive it away? The love of Christ. If you're uncertain about 2019, I don't know what's going to happen this year. I don't know how I'm going to make it. I don't know what's going to come down. You know what's going to drive that fear away? The love of Christ is going to drive it away. Perfect love drives out fear. Every time I think about that, it reminds me of a story I once read many years ago. And I used it in a message about a group of botanists. You know what botanists are? They're people who study the science of plants. Well, they had a group of them that understood that there was a certain time of year this rare flower was going to bud. And they went out searching for it. Well, a group of guys, they were searching, and somebody spotted one of these flowers. The problem was, is that it was hanging down on the side of a cliff. They couldn't get to it. And one of the men noticed that one of the men had their little boy with him. And he had the idea of, let's tie a rope around him, lure him down off the cliff, let him pick the flower, and we'll bring it back up. So they asked the father, can we do that? Can we tie the rope around your son? And we're going to drop him off that cliff, let him pick the flower, and pull him back up. Well, the father said, well, let's ask him if he's willing to do that. So they went to him and explained to him what they wanted to do. And they said, well, are you willing to do that? He says, yes. He says, I'm willing to do that under one condition. They said, what is that? My father holds the rope. See, he knew that the father's love would never let him fall. He says, I'll do it. But my father got to hold the rope. You see, this is the hope. See, our father is holding the rope. Why? Because he loves us. And this is the thing we have to understand this year is the love of God. We don't know what we're going to face this year. But if we are filled and we're grasping the love of Christ in us, that God loved us so much that he went to the cross of Calvary and died for our sins to give us eternal life, you got to know that love. You have to know that love. That's what Paul prayed for. Paul prayed right in the middle of that line. I got to stop for a second here. You guys, I got to pray that you guys will somehow be rooted and established in the God's love. In the love of Christ.
Amen.
So then, if we are established like that, then there's no fear in 2019 what it's going to bring. Our hope rests in the love of Christ. See, love is the first mention of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit comes into you, the first out of the 9 gifts, love. Love, joy, peace, goodness, kindness, all of that. But the first one is love. When you accept Christ into your life and you realize that he died for your sins, your guilt, your shame, everything you've committed in your past, the love of God just flows in you. A love that you don't even understand flows into your heart, into your life, into your soul at the point of salvation. The moment of salvation, you experience the love of Christ. So our success as a Christian is us having faith in the love of Christ. The Lord revealed to me, you hear me speaking about Chalmette all the time and how we grew and we had 600 people. The church couldn't fit anymore. We're winning people before Katrina. How it became a soul-winning body that was on fire. It was on fire. And you know, we had a ministry structure there, the Princewell 12, and we had 60 groups out there like we're trying to start here. And it was a structure to hold the souls that God was giving us. But the church was being rooted and established in the love of God. See, when we are rooted and established in the love of God, then we're going to love God. Our theme for our ministry is loving God, loving people. That's it. You love God, you automatically are going to love people. See, we love God. We love to worship God. We love the lost. And that's when you are rooted and established in love. See, we show our love for God by worshiping him. That's why some people come and say, you don't sing too much. I don't sing too much. I'm going to be singing for eternity. When I'm around the throne of God, that's all you're going to be doing. You ain't going to be able to sing enough. You'll be singing for 10,000 years. And still ain't going to be enough. So you just well get used to it here. There's going to be a lot of singing in heaven. But we show our love for God by worshiping him. You can't worship God. You don't know him. See, you can't worship a God you don't know. But if you know God, you know his love. You know what he did for you on the cross of Calvary. You're going to worship him. Listen, I walked into a church 46 years ago. I saw these people raising their hand and jumping shot. I thought they were nuts. But the next week, when I heard that gospel preached, that the blood of Jesus was going to wash my guilt and my shame away, and I went to my knees and accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior. Next week, I was in with him. I was raising my hand. Because now, I know the God that they're worshiping. I couldn't worship a God I didn't know. I know what they were doing. But when you know God, you're going to worship God. Then you're going to worship him. You're going to fall down and you're going to worship him. You can't love a God you don't know. But when you get to that point of loving God and having God loving you, then you're going to have the love for lost. See, this the only way this church is going to grow is that each and every one of us in our world where we are. And that reminds me I think Daniel in his group, he's inviting 2 people from his work to one of his groups. See what's happening here? See, it ain't just about us 4 no more. I'm just looking at those I work with who are lost, that need Christ. I'm going after them. See? And when that begins to multiply, then you'll see a church grow. If we have the love of Christ, we're filled up with the love of Christ, we're going to love the lost. We're going to know that people have a need in their life that we can help them with. And we're going to go deal with that. Paul prayed that the church would be able to do this. Verse 18. Grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Here's a love that surpasses knowledge. You know what that means? That means as a believer, you can't even rationally go and explain this to somebody. It surpasses knowledge. I don't have enough words to explain to you what the love of God's all about. The only way you're going to understand it is you're going to have to experience it. Because it surpasses knowledge. There's no way you can even put it in words. So our hope for 2019 is that we've got to stay connected to the love of God. Because you see, there are forces that will try to separate us from the love of God. To get us to doubt God's love for us in trying times. In other words, you're going to go through hardship. Now we say, God don't love you. That ain't working for you. That church ain't working for you. The devil's going to come and try to separate you from the very help that you need. Going to try to separate you, put doubt in your mind that it ain't working. You're wasting your time hoping in Christ. He wants to separate it. But look what the Word of God says in Romans 8:35. Paul says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble, or hardship, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword, as it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Paul says, no, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. I like that. Listen, we have seen many. Me and Pastor Joe talk about the short time, a few years that we've been trying to put this church together. How many has come and how many has turned away? How many that soon as they find themselves in a little pickle, they find themselves in a little trial, they find themselves suffering a little bit, turn away from the one who is there. Turn away from the love of God because of a little tribulation. See, there are many forces, I want to tell you, that comes against your pastor that tries to discourage me from doing this ministry. He comes and says, you're not going anywhere. The people don't want you. The people, they don't like this. They don't. Y'all not going to get it done here. There's forces that constantly come. And I know there's things in your life too that you will face this year that's going to challenge you to put doubt in the love of God for you. But Paul said they're going to come against you for one reason. That is to separate you from the love of God. Think about it. His biggest tool is to get you separated from the love of God. to let trials and tribulations come into your life, temptation, he can do that, to get you to turn away from the love of God, to separate you from what God has poured out into you. But the Apostle Paul says, no, no. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. We'll be more, I like that. We're not just going to be conquerors. I'll be more than that. Oh, I'm a trample on the devil's head. I'm a trample on anything he throws my way. Any trial, tribulation he wants to bring to me. I'm going to be more than a conqueror. I'm going to go on top of it. I'm going to jump over that wall. But we need to remember the process. We need to remember the process. Paul said, not only so, but we also rejoice in our suffering. Because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character. Character, hope. And hope that does not disappoint us. Because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom he has given us. Hope doesn't disappoint us. Why? Because God has poured out his love in our hearts by his Holy Spirit. So, how are we going to begin this year, 2019? I say this. Why don't we let the Holy Spirit pour out God's love into our life? Why don't we let God just pour out his love into our hearts and into our lives so that we will have the hope that no matter what 2019 brings our way, we'll survive because we're going to grab a hold of the love of God that's for us, and no matter what comes our way, the love of God will fill us up, and God will let us know just how much he loves us. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. Whoever believes in him, whoever believes that God loves them, will have eternal life. You ready to face 2019?
Yes.
God wants to pour out that love.
Yes.
How's he going to do it? By the Holy Spirit. I want you to stand with me. We're going to worship God. We're going to worship God and tell God, pour out the love now in our hearts and our lives. I want to survive 2019. Hallelujah.